There's several items under there, courthouse, fourth and fifth floor build out, courthouse annex, and then jail. You want to go through them like that, or you want to do an overview and we'll ask questions along the way?
If it's okay with you, I think we'd start with the flooding.
Okay.
And get that behind us, and then we go into the
Floor.
So everybody's aware that there was some flooding on Maple Street. Dates moved me a little bit, but as late as Sunday. One of the things that we wanted to explain to this committee was that there is a temporary line that goes around through the new jail, Sally Port, around the back and ties back into the 54-inch storm outfall line that goes all the way down to the creek on Castleberry. That temporary line did not take the volume of the rain on the last two big rain events. And Henry, if you'd like to take it from there.
Okay. Henry Painter with Turner Construction Company. As you're aware, the site where the existing jail sits, there was a parking lot where the new jail sits. That lot had flooding issues prior to construction. The design team put together a plan to incorporate an upgraded 54-inch stormwater system that runs across Veterans, through the bank parking lot, and down Castleberry Road. The way that line is connected, it actually crosses Veterans from the courthouse, goes through the jail sally port, and at that point will actually run underneath the footprint of the existing jail. That section of the upgraded permanent line cannot be installed until the existing jail is vacated and the inmates are moved out and the building is demoed. So during construction, the temporary line was put in place. There was constraints on the size of the line that could be put in because of the proximity between the existing jail and the new jail. The last 2 years, that line's been in place and there's been no issues. Due to the heavy rain that we got on May 27th and June 1st, we had an inch and an eighth of rain within an hour's time frame and an inch and a half of rain in a 35-minute time frame Sunday. The lines could not handle the water. It went back and had the same issue that you had when there was a parking lot there, and that's due to the upgraded lines not being installed. After the event last Tuesday, Turner Winter Construction took some extra means and we brought out a large truck pump to help try to relieve the lines. And the rain that we received on Sunday, this pump and the natural gravity flow could not keep up. So we've gone out and we've added some relief trenches and some additional relief water lines that were being installed the last few days to help relieve that issue. There was a large storm that came through last night at 3 a.m. We had folks on site monitoring, and there was no street flooding of Maple last evening. What we've also looked at doing is we've talked with the City of Cumming Sheriff's Department, and the unfortunate event, if there is any flooding that occurs and Maple Street, we would be able to get a squad car from the city to block off Maple Street herself for the public's protection and the protection of the pedestrians. There was no damage to the new jail or the courthouse. The water level did not rise to that height. Joe, that's pretty much the scenario. Is there anything you'd like to add? Oh, this was not uncommon to just Forsyth County. This storm is a storm that also flooded the downtown connector in Atlanta and other surrounding city streets and creeks within Forsyth and surrounding communities. We do feel it was a unusual heavy rain that you couldn't predict, and our neighbors south of us couldn't handle it either. Any questions?
Henry, I've got one. I know we're going to go over schedule in just a minute. Can you give the group some idea when the jail will be vacated, when it will be raised, and when the new 54-inch pipe, extension of 54-inch to connect to the other 54, might be completed?
Yes, we're looking at the jail staff being able to move in the early part of July. And after that move-in time frame, there will be some abatement of the existing jail, which should take 2 to 3 weeks. At that point, you'll be into mid-August where the jail will be able to be raised and the new 54-inch connection will be installed in the mid-August timeframe through September.
Thank you. Any other questions, Mr. Payne?
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
As normal in this meeting, I start out with we start out with a list at the first of this project about what was coming up, what approvals were needed, what board actions we needed, and we're down to the bottom of the list. The material completion on the courthouse is complete. Final completion has been done. We're working on warranty items now and a few pending punch list items. The material completion for the jail is pending. We have received notice from the contractor that he was ready for an inspection on last Friday, and the architect and David Stewart are working on the punch list to see if they can get final completion. There's a fire marshal inspection this afternoon, which will also enter into the decision to get material completion.
Joe, will you do me a favor for the group? Will you explain the difference between material completion and final completion?
Material completion, as defined by the contract, is that the building is ready for its intended purpose and that any punch list items or any items remaining to be finished can be all done in 30 days. The material completion for the annex, the existing courthouse, is 7/28/15. The material completion for the fourth floor build out is 6/29/15. This is a kind of a macro schedule showing that we're in the training and inmate move-in for the jail period of time frame in the next month. We hope to start demolition, and we won't be really demolishing the jail for a couple of weeks, but we've got some testing to do for hazardous material, and we've got some abatement activities to occur, but probably the latter 2 weeks of July we'll be doing the demolition. We're doing renovation on the existing courthouse, repair on the existing courthouse now. It would extend through the end of August. Then there is the fourth floor build out that is complete at the end of June. This was the last budget that the committee approved and saw. And one thing I'd like to point out is that we had two parts of change order number two, which is you see about halfway, about a quarter of the way down on the left side. We had the annex in the sheriff's office as a part of change order two within this budget, even though it was not identified in SPLOST, and we had the fourth floor build out within this budget. At that time, we thought we could accommodate it. The things that were at risk were completing the storm outfall line coming up Banks Avenue, and of course the annex. When we got into the last portions of the outfall line, the storm utilities coming up Banks Avenue, and we've got a whole series of timelines to talk about with you on that. We ran into a lot of unsuitable soil, rock, buried trash, you name it, we found it on the way to the final destination, the outfall line. We also, when we got into and were able to get above the ceilings of the annex, discovered a lot of things at the annex that we did not anticipate. So to give you an idea, first of all, on the outfall line, we want Henry and team to kind of address what they found and give you a picture of what was part of change order one, what was part of change order two, what was the original scope, and then what we found since then. So if you can turn on the lights.
All right. Get your bearings. This is Castleberry Road. This is the Wells Fargo Bank with the existing jail sitting in this area here.
What's that?
From the side, I think that might help.
I don't know if he's checked out on that or not.
Come on over here.
Checked out on that.
That way everybody will see over.
I've been known to turn it yourself.
The self you taught and I would.
This is Castleberry. This is the Wells Fargo Bank parking lot with the existing jail in this general area. The storm line actually leaves the jail, cuts through the bank parking lot, goes down Castleberry, and daylights directly across from the fairgrounds. The initial schedule was to start in May and be complete with all the utilities, including the water line and the sanitary line, in September. As we started the work, on day two, we encountered 50 cubic yards of rock that had to be blasted and removed. That is the red timeline it took to remove that rock. And then we picked up another 603 cubic yards of rock in this general area. That relates to the delay of the red bar in the schedule. We got through the rock, and then we started to encounter existing storm pipe and structures that were not shown on the documents and or indicated on the utility locate. The city and the county came out and helped identify what those utilities were, if they were old utilities or if they were active. We encountered the Atlanta gas line, a gas line that was also not indicated. We picked up AT&T duct banks that were also not indicated and shown. As we kept moving down, we then picked up...
The AT&T duct banks were abandoned, is that right?
The AT&T duct banks were abandoned, yes, Joe. But what we try to do is we find a utility before we move any farther to make sure it is not an active duct bank so we do not put anybody out of service. So we take the same precautions to make sure we know what it is before we move forward. As we moved down, we encountered a City of Cumming water line that was also not on the drawings or indicated. The city and the design team got together. We had it as built identified, and we actually had to reroute or wait for some rerouting of the existing water line in order to progress with the storm line and the sanitary line. And that occurred in this general area and also in this general area.
Henry, can you also indicate where change order one and two, we've already accommodated some of those things?
Yes, what we, change order one, we accommodated this schedule here. And in change order one and two, we picked up the rerouting of the water line coming through the Bank Avenue area. And that's where the next challenge came in. As we came down Bank Avenue with the water line itself, got prepared for the boring underneath Veterans Memorial, we started hitting rock 2 feet underneath the pavement of the road itself. You have a 54-inch storm line that also needed to be jacked and bored underneath the road. And by going through the rock, your potential cost was going to bump up into the close to $1 million. The construction team, design team, county, Doug Dare, and Joe Lee looked at options. At that point, we went and did some exploratory work in this general area. We took the hydrovac vacuums and did a series of hydrovac exploratory holes to determine where there may not be rock in order to try to get the sanitary and storm line through. The sanitary and storm line were originally to be put in this general area. The only location that did not have rock was actually in this general area, and that seems to be where the old creek bed used to run that we've been struggling with throughout the course of the project. That is also where the existing crossing occurs. So we were able to identify the gas lines that run parallel with Veterans and the duct banks, and we were able to get an area that we could get the storm line underneath the duct banks but above the rock. Once we made that crossing, then we got into the bank parking lot itself. Once we got in there, we encountered some additional rock that could be removed, a septic tank that had been abandoned, a trash pile was encountered, and unsuitable soils. So this work had to be remediated and removed, and it pushed the completion of the sanitary and storm out into April 13th. Now, why is that important? You cannot do some of your finishes inside of the jail without having your water line and or your storm line to take the water back out. You cannot start your boilers until you have your water and your storm line, which means you also are not able to put in the sealed concrete floors, the ACT ceiling, based on good construction practices. Joe, is there anything I missed that you need to add?
No, I'm not done. I'd ask for questions.
Any questions I can?
Did they change order cover?
Change order cover up until we got right in here.
So we have a.
We've got about $622,000.
We have a covering cost.
We have covering cost right there.
Any other questions? Let me hand back the laser to.
Well, while you're still up.
Yes, sir.
Can you and Doug, of this $1.5 million change order that we have estimated and are in agreement about scope, that's about $622,000. All right, so there's another, almost $700,000, sorry. And then there's another $600,033 in the annex that we have found. So could Doug and you start addressing these pictures, and then I'll pull some other pictures up.
So at this point in this line, we are over, I estimated.
We need another $600,000 to finish.
Just for this line?
Yes.
Okay.
Now that includes the 54-inch outfall line. And remember, the water line, the city decided not to do their portion they were going to do in Veterans Memorial.
Yeah.
So we had to hook up down banks again. So it includes that, and it includes the sanitary sewer that's coming up through there as well. So it's all three of those lines. Then the annex, and Doug, if you'd start with kind of the bones and infrastructure of the annex, explaining some of that, we'd appreciate it.
Yeah, I know these photos are really small, but and then Joe, I emailed Joe some other photos that we might be able to see on the larger screen. So as you know, when we originally were looking at the annex project, there were three main goals. The main goal, number one, was get the heat and air working right. Number two was make sure it was secure. And number three was doing the architectural wall movements in order to make it functional for whoever was going to move in there. And as you remember, we are designing the building for future magistrate to come back in. Probate's going to be on the bottom floor, and the second two floors were still have the concept that magistrate can move in that in the future. Okay. All right, so as we started demolishing the ceilings on the annex, we found all kinds of things that were making the that's going to make the building a lot more complicated. Number one,
I'm getting there.
You're getting there?
I'm getting there.
Show me the one. Let's show the wires first.
Was that the first one you sent me?
Yeah, that's it. All right, so we started removing ceilings. Who's got the little?
There you go.
That'll do.
Cut the load.
All right, so this is in the first floor. We pulled down the ceiling panels and basically wires fell on top of you. The code doesn't allow any wires to be on top of ceilings. So a big part of what we've got to do now that we've got ceilings out and to remediate the construction is to pull all those wires, tie them up, put them on hooks or whatever so they're off the ceilings. It's a code requirement. That's one of the big ones. This one is interesting. When the building was originally built in 1977, they didn't build the firewalls correctly. This photo is actually upside down, so I apologize about that, but if you could rotate it 180 degrees, you're looking up a block wall, and what you're seeing is wood finishing the top of a firewall, which doesn't need code. So once we got ceilings down, we found this issue. One of the things we're going to talk about is as part of the budget, we weren't able to finish from a paint, carpeting, and wall standpoint. Okay, let's go back to this one now. You switched on me. So this is another firewall issue. We've got unprotected steel going into a firewall. All that has to be wrapped in sheetrock and rated. Just another thing we found, holes in the firewalls. A lot of this, I think, is kind of legacy code issue, stuff that was there in the original construction. Joe, can you go to, I think there was another one I wanted to show. The top of the wall. All right, so this is the elevator shaft right here, this block wall. And what you're seeing is, again, gaps in the shaft. They used regular sheetrock to close up the shaft. All elevator shafts are supposed to be rated enclosures all the way up. So when they originally built this, they did not do that. And again, the top of the wall ends at a piece of steel, and that steel has to be wrapped and rated in order to protect that whole enclosure. So once we got above the ceilings, we found all kinds of I kind of call them legacy issues associated with the annex that moving forward we're going to have to address.
Yeah, let me back up one minute. When we The original budget, $1 million budget for the annex was to essentially repair the HVAC system, replace the HVAC system because it's beyond its useful life. And we were going to, and then just paint and patch, basically, to get ready for the next occupant. To do that, we were going to meet the existing codes that were in place at the time it was built, not the new codes. So this is not a full-scale renovation. It's a repair in place, just get it ready for the next occupant. We're not going to the new codes. And then we find that it didn't meet the old codes, which working with the fire marshal, you know, he's saying, well, you gotta meet the old codes. And this is why we're bringing this to you, is because of the issue. In my terms, it would be a construction defect from the 1970s. Architects use legacy because it sounds nicer.
Did we not raise some ceiling tiles like this before?
We did raise ceiling tiles, but we couldn't get into, for example, this elevator shaft. We couldn't get into those areas without disturbing operations that were going on in the courthouse or destroying stuff. And Chairman, even if we did, we had used up the budget up until that point. Now, you know, Doug and I had a lot of discussion about this, of whether this is a county master planning issue that, you know, how far do you go with the courthouse? So what we're recommending to you today is just to meet the old codes to make it safe for those occupants that will be in the courthouse for the next 7 to 10 years. It is not a full scale, make it meet new codes, make it ready for the next 50 years. Because the building is almost 40 years old now, and you know, it will need another major renovation in the next 10 or 20 years.
Now, is our fire department okay with going back using the old code of 74?
Doug, you might have to.
Yeah, I mean, they, yes.
Okay, good.
That's the short answer, but we can't get around the things we're finding.
The HVAC systems, do they have to be replaced right now? Can we duct works in place and changes at a future date and swap the money around, use it what you need now? I mean, they are working now, correct?
Not very well. They're working and not very well, plus they have asbestos mastic on the joints of the medium pressure duct work.
They're gone, that's what.
So
they've already been demoed.
Gotta go.
Gotta go.
We've always planned on that too. I mean, we've always need the heat and air conditioners. We'll probably spend more electricity. We'll save on.
You were spending four times the rate of the new courthouse and the old courthouse on electricity.
We'll save some money there in the long term. But
yes, sir. You are.
So, Doug, are we in the aspect of all this?
Yeah, we are. As part of the renovation as well, we had some discussions, and some of the areas we weren't touching, they actually painted around furniture. So you could actually see the shadow of the furniture that was there on the wall. So we've added some finishing to the building as well, because...
Why didn't we just use the same furniture back?
We did reuse a lot of furniture out of the annex and put it into the new courthouse. I know, Judge Bagley, you reused some of your furniture, right?
All of it.
Yep. So, but it was issues like that that we ran into. When the move happened as well, the walls got kind of banged up. Pictures being pulled off the wall and holes, so we needed to go back and float the walls. So there's some money in there for that. So what we're talking about today is a fresh coat of paint on pretty much everything, replacing the carpet on everything, and fixing the ceiling tiles. One of the things that reason we're doing the ceiling tiles is one of the things the fire marshal pointed out to us is that broken ceiling tiles are a code violation as well. So we've got to
have looked at the different options, like the spray foam on the metal beams to the sheetrock around them.
Yeah, Henry and I were working together on the easiest thing. We think that laminating sheetrock on them is the easiest thing. But
Chairman, like the last change order, let me jump in there a minute. But like the last change order, what we want to do is present you guys the estimate of the change order first, and then we go to get it trimmed up.
Okay.
All right. So we haven't done all the trimming yet.
Okay.
Yes, Mr. Shaw and Wakefield Beasley and Turner, Winter Team, has tried to go through the existing annex and reduce costs where possible, do what is smart, and use drywall, double layer to get the fire rating, because it's smaller areas and trying to fireproof the whole area and then try to use firewall.
And I did want to say that the local fire marshal, Robbie, has been working with us. He's been working with us to be reasonable in his assessment of the building. I think I appreciate his cooperation and his effort.
Okay. All right. Stay where you are. That completes all but $225,000. The last $225,000 is fire marshal changes. We're calling fire marshal changes for general courthouse, which means that the interpretation by the state and local fire marshals didn't match up with the interpretation with the architect, and so we had to make some changes. Can y'all give them a couple examples of the major ones of those that make up the 225? There are a lot of little ones.
Can I clarify what you just said, then?
Sure.
All right, so here's the normal process. We do the design work, we interpret what we think the code is, we send it downtown, right? And they review it, and they either agree or disagree, and they mark up my drawings, we fix the drawings, and then we give it to Henry to build. So Henry's out there building exactly what was reviewed downtown. What happens is the fire marshal who's in the field doesn't agree with the fire marshal downtown on interpretations. So
So what the final say of the building was the fire marshal in the field, not the fire marshal downtown.
You say downtown, you mean Atlanta?
Atlanta, yeah.
State fire marshal.
The state fire marshal. So it's really not my interpretation versus the fire marshal. It's actually the interpretation between the downtown guys and the field guys. So we had to add a bunch of exit signs, exit lights, emergency fixtures, things like that.
New ceiling.
Yep.
He wanted some change of egress routes where he wanted to put encapsulated hard drywall ceilings where it was drop ceiling.
Which one was one of the major ones?
Yes.
And then the voice recognition, voice enunciation.
That would be courtroom, that's sign-off part. They had electrical to the sign-off.
Another one was the handrails, all the handrails all over the plaza. They called that a means of egress. We don't necessarily agree with that, but the fire marshal field believes that it's a means of egress.
Now, it's a chicken and egg thing, because without the fire marshal's approval, there's no certificate of occupancy. Without certificate of occupancy, there's no final completion. So we were up in rock and hard.
I've got a question. Might be a little difficult to answer, but Doug and Henry, have we, Doug, as far as the annex, have we removed enough tile? Have we looked under things, behind things, so that you feel, to the point where you feel like we've got a really pretty good idea of what else needs to be done to this building to make it code compliant and presentable to the occupant? Or is there a chance that during our continued work, you'll find other things that need to be corrected?
I cannot stand here and guarantee that everything has been vetted out, but I would say that based on the removal of the tile and the exploratory behind some of the walls, you are probably at 99%. And the reason I state that is we have removed the drywall where it calls from the demo. We have removed the ceiling where it calls from the demo. So we've been able to verify all those locations.
Thank you.
Any other questions? All right, there are a couple of disputed items. One is the extended overhead for the off-site utilities, of which the contractor and our office, David and I, are reviewing, which we've got some disagreement about because of current delays. And we're doing some analysis of the schedule, when things were completed, and that is just not complete yet. We also have some dispute over the extended overhead for the annex, and Henry and I began working on that last Friday, I think, and aren't complete yet.
What do you mean by disputed exactly? Did it work against us or in our favor?
I'm in your favor. He's against you. And I don't mean to be facetious about that. They have, and us interpreting the contract, we think they're asking too much. And we're trying to come to a consensus about that.
You're thinking it wasn't in the contract, the bid they gave, and then wanting additional funding, you're saying no, it was included, or a portion of it was?
On the off-site utilities, we're saying that there were some concurrent delays that Turner Winter caused that shouldn't be in that calculation. And they've already taken some days off, so it's not like we're, at loggerheads 100% yet. I mean, we're still back and forth on that. On the annex, because we've got things going on the project, we think the contract amount of the full extended overhead amount doesn't apply. And so we're having some discussions about that. Henry's already indicated another amount for that, but I don't have it in writing, so I wasn't going to put it in here until I have it in writing. So we're still
it should be less than what I'm showing. And then the other thing under consideration, not disputed, but under consideration of how we're going to fund it, is the architectural, extended architectural construction administration services for the jail. So we're, Doug and I are talking about that, how we, there may be another funding alternative for that, and I'll have to explain that at another meeting. All right, so where does that leave us with the budget? Given that the two items I mentioned beforehand on the fourth floor build out and the sheriff moving to the annex were not part of the SPLOST, original SPLOST scope. And if you take those out, then we would, we can complete the project with a $500,000 owner contingency still in place, and then we're still under budget $341,000. Okay, so that's where we are if we take those other two items out. That would leave the scope that's not identified in the SPLOST for the annex and fourth floor to be funded from another source. And that's the presentation today. If you'd like to ask a question, we've got everybody here with me.
Go back to the one picture back, Mr. The unfunded source, please. Joe. $1,293,000
Yes, sir.
And that's what court you're proposing as non-SPLOST.
Yes, sir.
Project. Yes, sir. We pick it up out of the. No, not out of SPLOST, but we pick it up out of
the. I think it's outside the scope of this project. I think we knew that. We did know that.
We thought we could come.
We thought we could accommodate it in within the $100 million project.
But now we came.
Right.
But now we're able to. So we need to pick it up out of somewhere else in the county budget.
And you know, if you go back, I guess, 3 years, Mr. Chairman, we were considering buying a separate building off site for future sheriff's services. That was somewhere in estimated, I believe, we were around 1.5 to 1.7, right? So that never took place. Here in order to accommodate future sheriff services is about 1.3. That also would have had to come out from a general fund or another source.
That's not only something Forsyth did before. That fourth floor build out, which we did to move things around, is part of it.
It is part of it. That's correct, to accommodate it. So you're still less than we would have done that building. Of course, we won't have that additional building, but and it would have also had to come out of a different source as well.
You know, we've accommodated a lot of things in this budget. I mean, almost just in rock, over $2.5 million, just in rock that we've encountered that we weren't expecting. So, and there, I've got a long list of those, but it's not here there.
Joe, we're covering the security plan as well. And is that in the 474?
Or is that? No, sir.
That's in SPLOST.
That's in SPLOST. Okay. That's in change over to.
What we'll do is if this committee agrees with pulling out that $1.3 million from the project budget, then we would then take this to the full board of commissioners and ask them to consider funding that from another source.
I think we've got one more meeting with this group, Chairman, and that is to bring the final numbers to you.
Okay.
And one other question. I'm sure our sheriff has been kept in touch on this. Is he okay with the whole plan still? Have you seen it, Wayne? Does everything look good?
Good.
Thank you. So no more surprises on as far as that.
That's what we've been through that the whole time. It's just that some of them keep popping up. But as far as risk goes, we're out of the only thing we've got to do now is demolish the jail, which we have added money or moved money from one line item to testing, so that we got enough money to test for hazardous material, and we got the abatement money that we need to abate any hazardous material in that jail. So we've got that covered. Then we grade for the parking lot. There's not much cut at all in it, so we're not going down into the dirt enough that we're going to find anything like rock again. Henry, where is Henry?
That's correct.
So we feel confident that we've 99% found all the boogers that would surprise.
There was some early value management to balance the site. There was savings early on to raise the site so they did not have hauled off the material.
Yeah, and I want to point out one other thing. I failed to mention this. When we routed that storm line behind, around the new jail, the original routing was going right down the center of Maple and down Veterans. And by rerouting it, we saved, if I remember correct, $200,000 or $300,000. So the rerouting around had some savings for us in using that temporary line.
Okay. I do have one question. Considering the unforeseen conditions and all the other issues we've had to deal with on the project, Joe, has Turner Winter and the county agreed on a schedule, a completion date? What some of the questions the board gets at times, and there are others in the community, are: will this project be done on schedule? So how do we explain that the schedule, because of unforeseen conditions and issues along the way, that schedule is actually bumped out or delayed, if you will, to another date? Do we know what that date is yet? How we explain that? The board explains to the public if it's still on schedule.
Yeah, here's. The contract, and I hate to use the contract on you, but the contract is the only thing we've got to administer this contract between both the architect and the contractor. And the contract recognizes that if you run into unforeseen circumstances like rock, or you have unusual weather patterns, then it is defined in the contract what you can allow for extension of the deadline of final completion. If you, so far, all those add up. We have not delayed, the project has not been delayed for poor performance, but it has not been delayed for the architect not getting finished on time. It has not been delayed because the owner has made decisions on time. It's been delayed by finding things underground that you couldn't see, and by acts of nature. So, you know, the way I explain it to my children is that we're on time except for those things. For those things that we can anticipate, those things we cannot anticipate, the contract legally allows for those extensions.
So what is the jail opening date now? We stay with the same, or we stay in?
We are actually staying with the same. Yes. As far as moving inmates, we're the same. Now, if you remember back in change order one, when we found all the rock and the high water table, we moved some things around so we could keep the same inmate move-in date, but gave them a little bit more time to finish the building.
Do you give the sheriff enough time to get in there and work all this stuff out?
We've got a specific plan how we're going to do it.
Okay. And we need to realize that the sheriff and his staff have been in their training since
February.
Yeah. Staff-wise, we're ready. We have enough staff to actually open it. We've got a specific plan of move in. We're good.
Okay.
Good.
You're good with it. Okay.
One question. Okay. If all inmates get moved out, how quick can we get the old jail tore down and get that line in?
First of September. There was, let me add one thing, there was some equipment moving that we discussed it. Were they aware of all of it?
In the old jail?
From, yeah, bringing equipment out of the old jail.
That's what Dave and I've got to talk about today, and I think Dave and Chris are supposed to be there too.
Yes, sir. It's just moving things, but that's.
Y'all have anything else? Henry or Doug, have anything else?
No, sir.
Any questions for them? All right, we'll move on to item two. Judge Bagley? Yes. Is this the lack of soundproofing?
It is, sir.
Okay,
yes.
I'm sorry.
Sorry. Yeah.
All right. Lack of soundproofing in jury deliberation rooms, attorney client meeting rooms, and judicial chambers, decibel testing. We noticed the first jury trial that I had in the new courthouse, as the jury was deliberating, the bailiffs are required to be stationed right outside the jury room door, because sometimes if the jury, you know, has a question or they reach a verdict, they have to knock on the door and the bailiff answers and brings it to me. And the bailiff instructed me that he could hear everything that the jury was saying. He could hear their entirety of their deliberations. So that was the first indication that something was not right, that shouldn't be. So contacted folks needed to hear about this, and so there is an issue with that. And
let me address it. Henry, you want to take that?
Yes. On the jury deliberation room currently.
Let me stop right quick. I need to explain one thing. We've got a system set up that every time there's a warranty issue like this, it goes in the warranty management program that contractor has that we watch. It also goes in the computerized maintenance management system. So anything like this that occurs as a warranty item does not in any way, there's a specific process for it and there's specific documentation for it. And so it has to be completed over here on the contractor side, and then Matt and David have to say, okay, yeah, check, that one's done too. So we've got two systems following these kind of warranty items. No, go ahead, sorry.
On the jury deliberation room, we currently, after receiving the notification that there may be some sound issues, we have installed some gasketing around the door frame itself on jury deliberation room near your office, Judge, and also put in a bottom sweep. We went to another jury deliberation room to put the gasketing and then installed a threshold. That is in there for review from the team, because there may be some concerns that you may not want a threshold for potential tripping hazards, where the sweep may be more feasible. So that's ready for review. Doug Shaw and Turner Winter has reviewed that, and want to make sure it meets your standards. If it is, then we will move forward with those additions.
So my understanding is you think it's the sound is coming from around the door and not through the walls.
Yes, sir.
And so you think that the walls are properly insulated, sound insulated.
We've back-checked the walls for the insulation. We've been to the exploratory. We found the insulation to be installed per the contract documents. And we're seeing that around the doors, that seems to be the weak link of the sound.
Well, what kind of insulation is in the walls?
It's a bad insulation.
It's not anything designed for sound?
Yes, it's an acoustic bad insulation. But it's a...
Doug, why don't you explain the STC records?
All of the spaces that you're concerned about, we designed what's called the STC rating, which is a sound transmission coefficient, okay? The sound transmission coefficient we hit for all of these spaces was a 50, which is kind of standard for, actually it's a national court standard for courtrooms, jury deliberation rooms, judge chambers, and things like that. So the wall design follows that standard. So what Henry and I did after first learning is obviously come quickly and try to assess the situation. We went to the jury room in, I guess, right down the hall from you. And we were talking through the wall, trying to talk through the wall, and every time we did anything, it came right through the door. I think Robin was with us as well. We actually went to the end of the room where the door wasn't, and you could actually hear the sound coming around and through the door into the hallway. So we feel pretty certain that the door is the cause of the sound transmission. But again, the walls are designed with these STC ratings, which
are these national standards?
We actually did our own little test yesterday, and with the
gasket.
You can still hear. This Robin said it's not as much as it was, but you can still hear. So I don't know if the threshold is the next thing, or what is the next thing, or maybe it's the door. What about the door itself? I don't know if it's a solid door or if it's...
It's a solid wood door.
Okay. So I don't know whether the door itself is the issue, but...
Well, if you're still having problems, and even with the threshold, we'll take a look at maybe the perimeter of the frame or something.
Right.
I'm pretty comfortable with the wall, but I do think it's the opening itself.
Okay.
Because I stuck my head above the ceilings, and they're built all the way up and caulked and all that kind of stuff.
And no matter what, we'll get it solved to your satisfaction.
Yeah, we'll get it solved.
So we're just making sure no corners were cut, you know, that, you know, they just put sheetrock up and we're good to go, you know. I want to make sure that didn't happen.
Let's go back to the walls to show and verify the insulation.
There was also, before they covered up those walls, there had to be an inspection, and so those inspections showed that there were insulation.
We'll keep working with you to try to get those doors where we can be comfortable that...
But do you agree you think it's the door itself?
Well, it sounds like it is,
yeah, okay.
Based upon what we've looked at. So
okay.
We just need to...
Figure
get that
door.
Fix around the door or in the door or something, so okay. That at least the sound is muffled coming from, jurors sometimes get excited talking about the case and they get their voices get loud, so
right.
We just want to make sure we get the sound not being clear.
I was in there saying some very nasty things about my college football team, so I want to get rid of that noise.
Okay. Any questions about that? I think that's we're moving along to try
yes,
to
sir.
Rectify that situation. I think the same thing is deals with the client meeting room, attorney client meeting rooms, judicial chambers. It's some of the same issues about the door. And, you know, certainly privacy is important when attorneys are meeting with their clients and their rooms. Obviously, that's privileged communications going on there. You don't want people hearing that, and so
right.
Those same door issues probably are going on throughout, so
right.
It's
right.
Not just the jury room, so
right.
We want to try to correct all of that.
Yeah, we recognize that, and that rating was on a lot of walls that of the spaces you described.
the other, in fact, Mr. Chairman, if I could go on to item
absolutely.
Three.
Yes, sir.
The noise in courtroom 501 from the water chillers above the ceiling. I'm conducting hearings and this roaring noise, it's just like overwhelming. It doesn't seem to be as bad in the morning as it is in the afternoon, but different times of the day, and it's worse at times than others, but it's just like this overwhelming noise that is very distracting to the court proceedings. So, and I've...
Yeah, we came to see and listen, and I think Henry and I are in the same opinion as the way the piping is run, it comes through and then turns and it's got a little jog up. And where the noise is coming from is those bends in the piping. So what we're going to do first is attack those bends.
We had an acoustician come in Monday morning to verify it was the chilled water and not the ductwork itself. They did confirm it was the chilled water line that was making the noise at the bends. Then we've researched it. There's some additional acoustic insulation that can be added around the bins herself. It should quiet that. We're prepared to install that as early as Wednesday or Thursday evening if that's acceptable.
I mean, that's something that has to be. I can't conduct with the roaring noise.
Okay.
I mean, whatever has to be done, the insulation, sound batting to.
It was supposed to be just a trickle, so it sounded like a waterfall.
So
little fun
that
play.
Has to be correct. Okay, so that's
are those metal pipes?
Yes.
Does that not vibrate the noise down the pipes? If you just do the bends, does it not extend the noise as it vibrates down the pipe a little bit?
We ask about the hangers too, because where the hangers connect to the steel to steel, you know, you will get that vibration as well. And the hangers are around the insulation, so there's a.
There's a 2-inch jacket on them already around the pipes. It's not a raw pipe going through.
I just didn't know if you just do the depends if you're not going to still have some.
May have to.
You may have to run down the pipe a little bit as well.
May have to.
Okay, I just want to make sure that's being taken care of, because obviously that affects our operations. The next item would be removal of bench in the jury assembly room. I'm not sure how that all came about. I know that the state court judges wanted a bench, you know, they wanted some kind of bench in the jury assembly room, and that sort of got discussed and talked about, and it happened, and now they're saying we don't really need that, and it's really in the way there for, you know, assembling and paneling jurors. We really, it's not needed, and I think it was discussed that it could be removed and taken out, and is that something that we're going to do or not, or what?
Judge, we're going to look at it and alter it. If it gets removed, we're not going to get Turner to do it, because they're okay. A little expensive to do that kind of work. Doug, if you want to.
We've talked about that, Judge, and Joe's put some pricing together for us. I think what would go along with that pricing, the work itself, might be some ad services as well. We want to try to avoid that. So if it's something that we need to handle, and we handle outside the project, then we can do it with our staff. How quickly are you looking to perhaps have it removed?
Well, the reason that it needs to be done is because there is a column in the jury assembly room that is in the way. I mean, I know it has to be there to hold the building up, but it obstructs the view of the persons who come for, you know, who are sitting in the jury assembly room. So if we can remove that bench, we can move the podium back to the wall, that wall. We can have the seating come forward, all the chairs come forward. We can arrange the seating so it's sort of around that column, so you don't have anybody sitting behind the column that I'm talking to or that the judge is talking to when you're impaneling the jurors, so we can see everyone, so that we're not having to, you know, look around the column to see the people who are maybe raising their hands to answer a question. So the removal of the bench needs to happen so we can move that whole operation back to the wall. We can arrange those chairs around that column and be more efficient in our jury impaneling. That's why that needs to be done. I mean, you know, it's not critical that it be done tomorrow or anything, but just as soon as we can work it in.
We can get the local guys over there next week or so.
Any time, you know, within the near future. I just want to make sure that it's something that's on our radar screen that we can start doing.
Joe, how's that bench attached?
It's a wood frame.
It's a wood frame. We'd have to replace the carpet. It's about $15,000 to $14,000, $15,000.
So the carpet would cut around it.
And we'd have to replace the carpet.
We got carpet squares.
Okay.
So we don't have to go back in with broad limbs. It'll be easy. Pull it out, easy. Put in new squares, and you're done.
Now, can that bench be used in the probate court?
We had talked about that. How much it can be.
Yeah, we're definitely going to be reusing the AV systems in that bench, and we could use them in the probate court in the annex, which would be a savings there.
Okay. With all due respect, I would like more than a couple weeks. If you're okay with timing, we can
absolutely. It's just, I just want to make sure it's on the radar.
Okay, yeah. Perfect. All right.
Okay. That's all I have on that, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Next item, Chief, I think you're going to handle this.
Mr. Chairman, I've come to you before. And the committee asked that we go back and come back with some specific drawings as to the Masons being able to put a very modest.
This is in your package.
Oh, thank you. A very modest 30-inch by 30-inch dedication flag with a Masonic emblem on it. And I know this seems rather small to those who are not Master Masons, Freemasons, if you will. But the Masonic Order would pay for it in its entirety. And if the committee is so inclined, perhaps it might be installed with little lag bolts right here around the corner from the pound capsule, if you're so inclined. So this is not unlike every all 159 other courthouses in Georgia, save only for the fact most of theirs are a true cornerstone. Ours is past that point now. It would simply be a dedication plaque, Mr. Chair.
Doug, you recall the size or dimensions of the cornerstones on that point?
It's 30 by 40, isn't that right?
30 by 40. 30 by 42, something.
The time capsule.
Time capsule. Cornerstone? Okay. Just to give you some perspective, they're asking for 30 by 30, and that one's 30 by 40 or 42. Okay.
It's actually nothing more than just a dedication plaque. Rather low key.
This is this. This committee had asked the them to come back with that information. This is for the committee for decision.
Is this a cost to us, or did the Masons provide it free?
I'll pay for it.
Have a problem. I don't have a problem with it either.
Any votes?
Yeah, it's happened because we had voted on it before.
I'll make a motion. We approve the Mason Cornerstone. What do we say it?
30 by 30.
30 by 30. Symbol.
Yes. Second.
Okay, there's a motion and a second. All those in favor, second by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? There being none, that passes.
Thank you. Take care of some courthouse annex, Chief.
It's
not paying attention to us, is it?
We're out here.
Chief,
I missed that.
I know. Take care of some of the Yorkona annex.
I'm going to look through that.
You're going to have a real nice day.
All right, the next two items are just updates. I want to make sure that in the previous meeting we had talked about hearing box microphones and the intercom system on the courthouse floor and fifth floor. I understand from the architect, owner, and obviously the contractor that's been completed. I just want to make sure that everyone's satisfied with the changes that were made, if in fact they were. With both those?
Yes, the jury box microphones, they're a huge help. Well, especially, I can speak to my courtroom 501, the large courtroom on the fifth floor. I mean, it was very difficult to hear the jurors, you know, speaking in the jury box. Any other speaker with a low voice, they don't speak up, and it's hard for the court recorder to get to record that without them being, you know, their voice being amplified. And these hanging mics are just tremendous help in that regard. So, yes, they're working. Intercom system, Robin, I guess, is functioning as it should. Is that right? So,
very good. Thank you. We'll close that out. That was from the February 23rd, 2015 meeting. Thank you for that. Next item is Ms. Beasley.
Yes, sir.
Are you prepared?
Yes, I am. Shall I just stand here? Is this okay?
Yes, that's fine.
All right. Here, go. Well, I have good news. I am not here to ask for any money. We finished on time and on budget with our ARC and board. And the phase one section of the art decor for the lobby in the courthouse, I believe all of you probably have seen that, and I hope you are pleased with it. It was the 9 documents that were ordered for the foundations of American law and government, and the will be 6 courthouse pictures. The 6th picture will be done in the next few months. That's the picture of the existing courthouse, and our artist Brian White was waiting until the foliage came out and it looked a little more like an established building. So right now there are 5 of those up. We collected $19,700 in donations, and so far our expenses are $19,245. We have a few more expenses that we will easily cover by the difference there, the $455. We have the permanent donor plaque going in today, and Matt is handling that with EC signs for us. And I want to say that several of you donated towards that, and that was very much appreciated. And the There are a couple of things to be reframed, and that will be done, but we have plenty of funds to cover that. So, are there any questions about the phase one?
Good.
Thank you. Thank you. All right, so the committee has now gone into phase two, and phase two was mentioned in some of the information that I had reported on as part of phase one. Phase two, we will be concentrating on public areas on the second floor, the balcony mezzanine area, the fourth floor hallway and rotunda, and the fifth floor hallway and rotunda. And because there's not a grand opening deadline like there was last time, we're sort of taking our time on this. It will probably take us about a year time frame. We have asked for money from the Forsyth County Arts Alliance as part of their normal annual grant process. We have, excuse me, we have asked for $10,000, which is the maximum they give any organization. If we get that, then we are planning to raise another $25,000 as the committee from local donations. And we have several plans for how to do that. One will be just to ask for donations again from different businesses and individuals in the community. We hope to, and this would all be based on approval from this group and or the Board of Commissioners, but we'd like to have note cards made of the completed six courthouses so that we would have a product to sell, and we would be doing that locally if that's approved. But they turned out very nice, and we thought that that would be something people would enjoy having as just a note card. We would be looking into any other grants that are available in the community, maybe Rotary Grant. All of these groups have different time frames for their grant process, so we would see what process we would hit at what time. We also have been gifted with the original artist proofs of the courthouse pictures. Those belong to the county, and we had considered having an auction for those. That's what Linear Tech did with the ones that they were gifted with from Brian White, White Lake Studios. So if that's done, then that would raise some money that way. But the Board of Commissioners could do anything with those they wanted to. If they would want them framed and put in another building, that could be done, or they could be auctioned off at some kind of like a little auction event kind of thing. So our budget for part two is $35,000. If we get the grant, if we don't get that $10,000, we will probably go back and revise that somewhat. But what we hope to do is to put permanent artwork on the second floor, and we hope to have rotating art collection from local artists, probably monitored through our Sony Artist Association, which is the one artist association in the county. That would be rotating art up on the fourth floor, and then we have a number of artifacts from previous courthouses and previous judicial institutions that we would be putting on the fifth floor. So, any questions? And we've changed over some of our members on our committee. We were very grateful to Susan Isbell with Wakefield Beasley and Elizabeth Sessions. And of course, their work is done, so they're not there on our committee anymore. We've lost a couple of other people just based on the time the committee meets. So if someone else wants to join us, or if you have someone that you think would be helpful, Carla Floyd has joined us from the county, so just let us know.
How many members do you have now, including Carla?
I think we've got 8, and we had about 12. So it does help to have maybe a few more people who can help with the fundraising.
Probably any action from this committee at this point. The committee and the board already agreed to accept donations. Is there anything else you need from us, with the exception of when you, I guess the next step may be to present a plan for phase two in the future?
We need to go ahead and get some more costs together for you. So as far as any other fundraising opportunities other than donations, we would just come back to you.
Okay.
Thank you
very much. Next item. John?
Sure. The risk management department, as well as the fire department, have been working together to standardize the AEDs in the county, which are the automated external defibrillators. They're a life-saving device or potential life-saving device. We do not currently have them in the new courthouse and new jail, and so that committee kind of met. We currently buy the cardiac science. They're just replacing it to the new G5 model, but it's the same type. type of unit. For the courthouse, they determined that we would need 8, and possibly in the jail there would be 2 at this time until they actually, the jail opens, we would look at it. The cost is an estimated at $14,000 total. They asked that this be brought to this committee to see if this would be something that would be funded within this project budget, or if the county take this to the board and ask it to be funded elsewhere. It has not been a determined line item at this time. Thank you.
I hesitate to, personally, I hesitate to use funds from the project budget at this point.
I liked that the fire department left and left me here by myself.
Yeah, they did. Yeah, I thought he was going to stay for you.
I did too.
Just invite him back to a board commissioner's meeting.
And that's fine. We'd asked this quite some time ago, so yeah. I will do that then.
Just bring it back to the board. Does everybody agree?
Yeah.
Okay. Super. Yeah. Thank you.
He's not here. He's taking his first name.
Yeah.
That's recommended.
Any other business to come before this committee?
I have one, Mr. Chairman. And, just to give you an update on our statue, Lady Justice. Actually, our court administrator and myself are going up to take a look at the mock-up, later today. I'm anxious to see it. I did get some word from the sculptor that there may be a delay. Did you get that word? Okay, I did get some indication that there may be a delay in the completion of the statue. Not sure exactly how long a delay, so we had originally thought about an unveiling in August, but that may be pushed back to September. I'll know more today after our meeting there with the sculptor, but things are progressing. It just may be, we're not sure exactly when the unveiling ceremony will take place.
There's good news. September's cooler than August.
Yeah. Very good. Thank you, Judge. Anything else to come before the board, Joe? Like you wanted to say something.
Did we get a vote on that? The first
change order.
Yeah.
Should we recommend to the board to approve it? I mean, if we feel like it's warranted, should we recommend
the third change order?
I think last time what this committee did was authorize us to go get the final numbers and bring it back. That was the only vote we needed.
Okay, but that's what we're going to look for out of. But the change orders we'll look for out. Other than SPLOST?
No.
20.
Change order three.
Yeah.
Yep. Last time you directed us to go get the final numbers and bring it back.
And that's the final number?
Yes.
Okay.
This is the final number?
No.
Okay. So we would be then approving you to go out and get the final numbers and bring them back to this committee first, and then we would take the board commissioners.
Right.
Okay. I move, Mr. Chairman, that we direct project manager to get the final numbers on the change order 3 and come back to us with the final numbers.
Second.
Motion and second. Any discussion? Joe, was that stated well?
Or yes. How quick would this be? Like a couple weeks we need to get this?
Yep. A couple weeks is the target.
Okay, so we have another call meeting.
Yeah. Okay. Any other discussion? Vote on the matter. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Being none, that passes. Any other business? Motion to adjourn.
I make a motion to adjourn.
Motion. Second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, being none, we are adjourned. Thank you all very much for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you. I need some
signatures. Yes.
Sheriff Plaque.
You may.
Can get his first.
Now I got to listen to it. I wasn't using it.
If you are, y'all go to town.
Do you go?
It's hilarious. And it's
yeah, we're going to meet.
Wasn't sure.
I was just still doing that or David?
Right now.
And I know that I reported on this last week when it happened. It looked like
we'll be talking
the deal online, like a flutter together the weekend. I guess we people are seeing more prepared now that they've gone through all ones. I guess basically this is going to be kind of working as it's intended to.
I'm not reading it, but I'm going
to. Hey, he's good, yeah.
I know, sometimes you get the plan.
So you'll see it's accessible. You're not actually in the official construction area. You'd be better off just putting on fire. Well, the general public can't get it.
Let me know when the general public can get it.
Yeah.
I've been working with Larry on Comcast as well. I've been working with Larry on Comcast. Aren't they? They're speed.
Yeah, I'll go ask them. Thank you.